The room is relationships. The room is you and me and everyone in America.
What are you talking about?
The room is different cookie cutter from Hollywood.
Yeah, man, you never know. People are very strange these days.
What's going on?
Welcome to The Room Minute,
the podcast where we get obsessed with the cinematic classic The Room,
1 minute at a time.
You have no idea what kind of trouble you're in here, do you?
Why are you so hysterical?
We always wanted people actually talk about it.
I did not hit her. It's not true. It's bullshit. I did not hit her. I did not. Oh, hi, Mark.
Oh, hi, Allison.
Oh, hi, Rob.
Oh, hi, listeners. It's time for Minute 35, in which shit goes down on the roof. Chris R. is no longer a pimp, and Johnny is no longer a vampire. Now, before we even get into the scene, this was the first scene filmed for The Room. However, we are not seeing that first scene that was filmed. It was filmed in the fake alleyway. Was filmed twice in that fake alleyway because Tommy did not like the guy who was originally cast as Mark. And purposely didn't run cameras when they were shooting him in this scene. Then got Mark to stand in.
Just like I always very easily mix up the names Johnny and Tommy. In the following exchange, you'll realize I keep referring to Greg as Mark.
Make an excuse that producers, that don't exist, wanted to see what Mark looked like on camera. And so then they shot the same scene with Mark, and they ended up using neither of those because a week or two later, Tommy decided the scene needed to be bigger and better and more spectacular, so they moved it to the fake roof and shot it again.
Great choice.
At this point, the original guy cast as Mark, his name was Don. Last name withheld. I still haven't figured out who it is. Had quit slash been fired. So had the original Lisa, who went with him. And interestingly, Chris R., Dan Jinjigian, was the original Mark's roommate in real life. That's how he knew of the audition and joined. So by the time they're filming this scene again, his roommate has now been fired from the production and is probably not very happy about it. Jinjigian had moved on, and when they called him to come to the set immediately, because Tommy's very impatient, he was at the grocery store with his girlfriend, and he's like, yeah, I'll come tomorrow. So he did come back on a day's notice to shoot the scene again, arrived in character again, and actually got extra angry because Tommy would not let him change any of his dialogue. So in The Disaster Artist, Greg Sestero actually says this may be the best directing that Tommy has ever done, but it's accidental. Now, in the original version of the scene, of course, this is Lisa's brother Billy on the roof dribbling a football.
Of course.
I'm not sure how that works. When the rugged drug-dealing pimp arrives, because as we will learn next minute, he has been prostituting himself in the script.
Wait, in the script he's a pimp?
Oh, hi, Johann.
Oh, hi, guys.
yes.
Hi!
In the original script, Billy, who is Lisa's gay brother, who has a thing for Johnny, has been prostituting himself for money. In this version of the script, and in the version of the story that we get in more detail from Philip Haldeman's comic, My Big Break, Denny has been originally just sort of delivering drugs to someone else who would sell them at the local community college.
Oh, okay.
For Chris R., and then selling them himself because he needed money because he wanted to be just like Johnny. He thought that's how you got a girl, is by buying her gifts all the time. The reason he does not have Chris R.'s money is because he bought a red dress, just like Lisa's, for his girlfriend Beth.
Oh, but he only needs 5 minutes.
Yeah. That's the thing I'm wondering is, where's the money coming from? What does he think's gonna happen?
Like the money's gonna walk up the staircase, they're like, see, I told you, but just 5 minutes. He has short legs.
Like, did he know that, like, Johnny and Mark were on their way up, and he figured either they'd end up paying off his debt or they'd take this guy to jail? What was 5 minutes going to buy him?
He had to take a trip to the money tree.
Well, and Billy, the original version of Denny, is a kind of a dick. He says sarcastically to Chris R., okay, chill out there, Grandma Ha, Supreme Leader of the Astra Galactic Command. Just hold your wiener for 5 minutes and relax. The cash is on its way.
That's a really nervy thing to say when someone's holding a gun.
Yes. It's also brilliant writing, because that's how people do it. Just hold your wiener for 5 minutes.
Here's where I'm getting... Okay, so let me try and analyze. Chris R. is a pimp, and Billy's supposed to kind of be in his stable.
Okay.
Slash a drug runner. So possibly the money could be that Billy has been turning tricks and not giving Chris R. his cut.
Yeah, yeah.
Possibly.
If you take the pimp side of things. Although, in the movie, of course, it is drugs, as we find out next minute. But yeah, it's...
yeah. Yeah, so... That's why we're cutting down like the stuff that is left behind. So
as we said last minute, it's such a different scene than so much of the rest of the movie, and then its individual parts of the scene itself don't quite fit together very well either.
Yeah. So what's left now is now he's a drug runner for Chris R, and he took the drugs, sold it to buy a red dress for his girlfriend. Now there's no girlfriend.
Well, he does mention her later, but yeah, we never see this girlfriend. We don't know that she's real.
So where's the red dress? Cause of,
yeah.
My girlfriend.
Yeah, she lives in Canada.
I wish you could meet my girlfriend, but you can't because she is in Canada. I love her, I miss her, I can't wait to kiss her, so soon I'll be off to Alberta. I mean Vancouver. Shit, her name is Alberta, she lives in Vancouver. She's my girlfriend, my wonderful girlfriend. Yes, I have a girlfriend who lives in Canada.
But now all that's left is the fact that he took the drugs, sold it for money, and bought a red dress for no one.
Well, really all that's left is he took the drugs, consumed them, or sold them, but for whatever reason doesn't have the money. The drugs are gone, but so is the money. We don't know why.
But... The drugs are gone, and so is the money. That's why all that's left is the fact that he bought a red dress.
Well, in the movie, that didn't even happen. In the movie, no drugs, no money, and Chris R. shows up on the roof.
So he's just that creep that may have a red dress in his room waiting to give it to somebody.
But in the movie version, I'd say more likely he has a red dress hooked around some pillows that he pretends is Lisa, but that's a separate issue.
A body pillow.
For his pillow fight in his apartment.
Yeah, I'm liking Chris R. more.
We're all going to come down on Chris R.'s side at the end of this.
Yeah,
for sure.
You sold me on this. Chris R.'s better.
Yeah, because he had been in My Big Break. Denny has been using his money from selling drugs to take Beth out to dinner. He bought her a bike so she could get around to campus easier. And then he wanted to get her a dress so she could dress up nice like Lisa. I haven't read issue 6 yet, but that's where we're going to get him actually buying the dress. He's talking about getting her a dress like Lisa.
That is just so weird. Because imagine like him going on a double date with Lisa, Mark, and Beth. And then Lisa and, or not Mark, Tommy, but... Lisa and Beth showing up with the exact same red dress.
No, I like that you included Mark in that double date in the first place.
Yeah, for some reason I was thinking it's Mark.
Well, no, it gets even weirder because in the film, Denny's girlfriend that they talk about but we never see is named Elizabeth. Mark's ex-girlfriend is named Betty. So that might be the same girl. So that double date would be even more awkward because I think Denny is dating Mark's ex-girlfriend.
Anyone's Mark's ex-girlfriend and looks like God, then it just makes it even weirder. Because then Mark is showing up with Lisa in his red dress, and then
they're both showing
wearing the same dress.
They've both had sex with and Mark, and Denny is just like, "Oh, this got weird."
And then
they're twins.
I wish Chris R. had shot me.
And Beth could go up to Mark saying, see, I look good in this dress. She doesn't look as good as I do, as you can tell.
Because Denny's
this just makes it way weirder. Yeah. Oh my God, this just... Chris R. break his ankles.
Yeah.
You have my money, right?
Yeah, it's coming. It'll be here in a few minutes.
Now, the dialogue, of course, here is very repetitive.
What do you mean it's coming, Denny? Where's... my money.
Okay, just give me 5 minutes. Just give me five.
5 minutes? You want 5 fucking minutes, eh? You know what? I haven't got 5 fucking minutes! I'm gonna ask you again, Denny. Where's my money?
I don't have anything.
Where's my money, Denny?
Where's my fucking money, Denny? Did you lose my fucking money?
I swear to God, it's coming!
Where's my fucking money, Denny?
Put the gun
rundown.
My fucking money!
Which is part of why Dan Jajigian got extra angry when filming this scene by the last takes, because he wanted to change the dialogue and Tommy wouldn't let him. Because he told him a real actor just follows the script.
That sucks. Yeah. That sucks for him. The thing is the way he did this role, he could have been on something like on a daytime thing like SVU or Law & Order.
He would have been that.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
Yeah.
Like, best actor in the movie.
I believe that he doesn't have 5 minutes and that he wants to shoot Denny. You know, I buy it.
Yeah, I believe it.
Yeah.
What I don't believe is when Lisa and Claudette are there in front of that really horrible green screen and their outfits are different. They're changed outfits. Like, how soon after the conversation did this happen? Because A, I thought the mom had just left. And B, the
Seems to happen in order? What do you think this is, a movie?
I like Lisa's line and dialogue in this line, in this minute, specifically because the intensity is locked from like the eyebrows through her mouth.
Yeah.
Like, nothing about her body language like says like this is an intense moment. It's just right there, just like those couple 4 inches of just intensity. Yeah.
This scene is brilliant. You know,
like she's not running to protect anybody. Yeah, she's just like, I can't even do it because like it doesn't even look like her diaphragm is even working up with intensity to get angry. Her shoulders are slack,
especially her opening line here. What's going on here? Somebody help!
Yeah,
which has no punctuation to it. Anyway.
Like she just runs every line like into one big line. But it's just all that intensity is just right there in the face. That's it.
Yeah.
It's so bad.
Now, scripted Billy is, of course, continues to be a dick. Jimmy, Chris R's original name, says, "What's the matter, Billy? Do guns scare you?" And Billy says, "Guns don't scare me. Idiots with guns scare me."
See? No. All right, so we're like near the end of this minute, and we're seeing all the bad guys ganging up on the good guy here.
Oh, we haven't even got to the best part yet, but yeah.
He's being, like, really bold calling someone that's holding a gun an idiot.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like, is he just, like, daring him to, like, shoot him?
Yeah.
Dare you to shoot me.
Because at this point, he's just basically telling him, like, oh, no matter what, you're not getting your money.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not going to generate. Like, it starts to come through.
Like, it doesn't matter. I can say whatever I want to say.
Yeah, it just starts to come through that it looks like my money is gone. And this guy's the responsibility of it.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, just wait 5 minutes, you know.
Okay. Just give me 5 minutes. Just give me five.
Play one of the game apps on your phone. It'll be here in 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Well, it's kind of like the apartment downstairs. If you wait 5 minutes, someone's going to walk in. So, of course, someone's going to come out on the roof if you wait 5 minutes. He's just hoping someone is going to be something.
Okay.
So
you're just living on a prayer at that point. He's like, please, dear God.
Like, someone, come onto the roof.
This is a
beat. His fingers across behind his back. Someone come.
this is a BB gun. It's not even like a stage prop, right?
I believe it is a toy gun, actually. You see it better. It's the same gun that they use in the suicide scene at the end, and you get a better shot of it. I believe I took a screen cap, and it is a plastic toy gun.
No, because at second 42, the CO2 chamber is right there, where you can plug in a CO2 so you don't have to really pull the spring back all the time.
I don't think I knew what that was on the thing. That's cool. I'll have to look up, see if I can find a specific model.
And then right by the trigger is a switch between a CO2 and pump.
Huh.
So this is a BB gun.
Nice.
Yeah.
Now, are you ready for the best part of this scene yet?
Wait, there's a better part?
Yeah. Okay, so they moved this scene to the rooftop to make it bigger and more spectacular, right?
Mm-hmm.
A few days before filming the second version of the scene, Tommy Wiseau goes over to the first director of photography, because he hadn't quit yet, Raphael Smaja, and he tells him, "I want my car to fly off the roof into the sky." Raphael says, "Why do you want to do this exactly?" And Tommy says, "It's just possible side plot. Maybe Johnny is vampire."
So there's this guy, Johnny, a true American hero, to be played by me. He has it all. Good luck, many friends, and also maybe Johnny is vampire. We'll see.
So this is how Greg describes the moment after. Raphael stood there, looking up at the sky. He began to nod. The next time I saw Raphael, he was laughing uncontrollably while he relayed Tommy's flying Mercedes-Benz vampire vision to one of the cameramen. Now, this moment is in the original script. Jimmy, Chris R., motions with the gun toward the side of the roof. Billy, Mark, Lisa, and Claudette move there while Jimmy holds them at gunpoint. Jimmy, say your prayers, wienerheads, because I'm about to make some Swiss cheese out of you. At that moment, the view changes to Jimmy's perspective as ominous opera music, such as Carl Orff's O Fortuna, or equivalent, starts to play. Johnny's Mercedes is seen rising slowly over the edge of the roof with Johnny at the wheel. As he hovers in the air in front and above the group, the music subsides. Johnny smiles, revealing long, fanged teeth.
No.
He is glowing. Johnny, do you know who I am? I have 9 black belts, 15 master's degrees, and a PhD in agricultural economics. That's right. You know I way better than you, and all my friends would gladly tell you just how great and awesome I am. That line right there is the reason some people think this version of the script is fake. But if it was fake, I think there'd be more of this ridiculous, not one scene left over. Have you seen my power level? It's over 9,000.
No.
You know what that means? It means I have more than 9,000 power. It also puts my total adjusted force rating at 22,000. That's more than triple. I don't know what it's tripling,
wait,
but...
Yeah, what... This is not tripling 9,000.
No. So you don't want to make me mad because anger is my middle name. Yeah. Trembling with fear, Jimmy manages to raise the gun and aim it at Johnny. He fires some shots, but Johnny extends his hand out the driver's side window and deflects the bullets. Next, Johnny emits a power field from his hand, which encompasses Jimmy. Jimmy thrusts his arms out to his sides and yells, "Don't touch Jimmy!" Johnny uses the field to levitate Jimmy, holding him high in the air until Jimmy drops the gun. A rear passenger door opens as Johnny draws Jimmy toward the car and drops him in the back seat. Johnny waves to the group waves back as Johnny and his captive fly off over the skyline, then upwards disappearing out of sight.
What the...
Sounds like a comic book.
See, but here's where... I don't know if that's fake.
I know. If there were more moments like that of really obvious dialogue, like, oh, my friends will tell me how great I am, then I would think the whole script is fake. But this is in the middle of a script that is otherwise pretty close to the final version. Other than a few character names changing. Denny's Billy and, you know, that kind of stuff.
Here's where I'm a little bit like, where I can't believe this is, like, kind of how it's happening. Because it's out of this movie, correct?
Yeah.
And if you said this was in the original script, I would probably go like, God, that's possible. I could have wanted to see that. Now, someone would hand me a script of this was the final way of, or just the conclusion of, let's say, Shawshank Redemption. I'm like, no way. But then in this one, I'm like, God, it's possible.
And you could imagine that it would come back, like this is where we find out Johnny's a vampire, and then that comes back into play later.
Which makes more sense.
But I don't know. Whether it is a real thing or not, I love it. And it feels like something that Tommy Wiseau would have written.
That's why.
So whoever did write it, if it's not him, did a great job.
Yeah, that would have been better seen.
Plus, we do have confirmation from Greg Sestero that Tommy did say he wanted his car to fly. So there was some version of this scene in his head, if he never actually wrote it. Which also makes me think it's real.
Well, because it starts to make sense, because in the original script, he was kind of like masturbating to the dress after he shot himself. So if he were a vampire... It would make sense.
Yeah, because
can vampires die?
Yes. Not by a gun.
Yeah. But yeah. Yeah, not by a gun.
Stake to the heart and sunlight, you know. He can handle sunlight.
Yeah. It's always debated that the older a vampire, the more it takes to kill him.
Yeah.
So if his power level is 9,000, his force level is 22,000.
22,000.
Yeah, a gun wasn't going to be able to do it.
It's going to take a lot to kill him.
Yeah.
Yeah, and 22,000 is more than triple 9,000. I know that. I have a PhD in agricultural economics.
How does that make sense?
Is that a thing, agricultural
economics? No, because a PhD in agriculture has nothing to do with economics. It would be a completely different field altogether.
Yeah.
You can have a PhD in economics, we'll say. And then you work in a field of agriculture.
Well, and he works at a bank, so he knows how that goes. In San Francisco, it's not like there's a lot of agricultural stuff going on at a bank. In San Francisco.
But he made software.
Maybe. Oh, my God.
They stole my idea. I saved the bank millions.
The bank saves money.
It's just like, oh, God.
And yeah, so Mark and Johnny show up in the film, and they go to take Chris R. to the police.
Yeah, they just walk him up,
which they will do in record time. But we'll find that out next minute. But they do it in so fast, like the police department is literally on the top floor.
Maybe that's where Claudia changed her clothes. it's all in the same building.
Well, yeah, she had to go home. Turns out her home is also in this building,
yeah.
Just like Mark's is. Just like Denny's is. Everyone lives in the same place.
It's a small town in San Francisco.
Yeah. See, if Johnny were a vampire, that would make sense why he has the money to pay for Denny's, like, rent or something.
Yeah, he's owned this building since, like, the 1800s. Yeah.
Yeah.
So he's really rich.
The entire town is just one building.
Well, it does fit with Tommy's, I think it was his next project, The Neighbors, which is the original title for this. Is that it's a big apartment building. It's like in charge of
it. Yeah, I tried watching that show.
Tried is the proper term here. Yeah.
I was like, I think it was like on Amazon Prime. It's where they,
when I watched it, it was still on Hulu, but I think I also have it on DVD.
Yeah, cause I remember I saw something like about it and I was just like a blonde haired Tommy was so, it was like, okay. And I put it on and I was like watching it and I was just like, no, I can't do it. It's just not the same.
No, it's not even a sitcom. It's like half-hour segments of a bunch of smaller scenes shoved together. There's no through line that ties episodes themselves.
Yeah.
That's how you know Tommy made it.
Right.
Yeah. It's like he wanted to do something like how Kids in the Hall do have all their own segments. But the thing is that sometimes they tie them together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So there's a running gag throughout the entire thing, and I don't think he got that part. But that he just
made the part.
The scenes that connected, in some way were in different episodes altogether. So
this is both the greatest scene in the movie and could have been better.
Claudette and Lisa are very fast dressers.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, assuming this scene takes place right after, they are quick.
Wow. All right.
So then I end with notes from a midnight screening.
Notes from a midnight screening.
There's only a few in this minute, I think. People just enjoy this minute too much. Oh, when Chris grabs Denny, people are screaming sex scene 3. Which is funny, because technically it would be sex scene 4, but they like to call the sex scene 3 sex scene 1, because it is a repeat footage. And when he points the gun at him, people scream no. They were against Denny last minute. They're with him this minute, once the gun's involved.
God.
And at one point, they're screaming, there's 3 minutes left.
God. All right.
They all cheer when Johnny and Mark show up, and when Lisa and Claudette show up, they're like, how'd they get there? That's pretty much it. Johann, once again, where can the listeners hear more of you if they want to?
Listeners, you guys can listen actively recording with Independence Day Minute, which is about Independence Day, and a previous project was Roughneck Minute, which is about Starship Troopers.
So it's not wrong when people make fun of the project, in this case, The Room.
The Room Minute is a production of Lemming Drop Studio.
You can find more content at lemmingdrops.com.
Follow The Room Minute on all the obvious social media. If you've got any stupid comments after the show,
you can leave them in your pocket on Facebook. If you like what you hear, throw us a rating and a review on your podcatcher of choice. Thank you for listening, and remember, if a lot of people loved each other, the world would be a better place to live.